venerable art institution in the country, going back to well before Abraham Lincoln. And then she did her MFA in Jerusalem at the Betzalel Institute, which goes back only to the beginning of the 20th century, but it is the leading institute for the training of artists in America. Her work has been shown all over the globe, and I will not tire you with an exhaustive list, but just mention that it's been at the Centre Pompidou in Paris, at the Biennale in Venice, in Munich, in Berlin, in Shanghai, in Sao Paulo, and in all kinds of other places. So there is a keen interest across the globe in Neera's work. I've been viewing it carefully over the last 3 weeks, and it is quite remarkable. She typically uses multi-channel showing, although not invariably. And as you look at the different pieces, you see that she's an artist who is constantly exploring the formal aspects of her medium and what it can tell us about the world that the medium represents. Many of the pieces are kind of instructive exercises in looking at the world visually. That is, many of them don't have sound, or very little sound, and not really dialogue. Some of them are don't have anything directly to do with politics and society, such as a visual inspection of the facade of buildings in Tel Aviv. Maybe the secret political implication there. Images of people in France in the throes of a heat wave, a kind of cube, and on and on. But on the other hand, I find that the way she explores political problems through the medium of video is quite fascinating. What strikes me is that there's no ideological insistence. The images are brought before our eyes, and then we're led to ponder what they might imply, especially if we know the context. And I'll just mention, before I turn the podium over to Neera Pereg, two examples. I think at least one, yes, I can see it on screen here, one I know she intends to show us. It's called Sabbath 2008, and it's about, I don't know, 8 or 9 minutes, in which two young ultra-Orthodox boys, Haredi boys, supervised by an ultra-Orthodox adult man, are dragging what apparently are rather heavy metal police barriers to close off their street for Shabbat. And that's all that's explicitly said. Now, if you know the Israeli context, you know that there are implicit issues of the aggressiveness of the ultra-Orthodox community. It's in Jerusalem, it's what I would call this imperial expansion. It's projecting itself into the public space and blocking off access to certain sectors of the public space. And all this comes across without insistence, without ideological haranguing in these images of the two boys and their adult supervisor. Well, you'll see that, and I hope Neera will talk about that as well. example that I don't know if you intend to show it, it is paired video pieces called Abraham, Abraham, and Sarah. Are you going to show that too? Oh, terrific. These are filmed in the Cave of the Patriarchs, which I should say in Hebrew is not called the Cave of the Patriarchs, it's called Marat HaMachpelah, which means something like the double cave or even the cave of doubling. And I think that doubling is very much part, as you'll see, these two pieces. That is, the arrangement for the last three decades at the double cave has been that 80% of the space is allotted to Muslims and 20% to Jews, and these are very Orthodox Jews. But on a couple of occasions during the year, each group gets to have full control of the space, and the other one has to clear out. And that's what is filmed. Now, this is something you don't have to be Israeli to know about. That is, the Cave of the Patriarchs in 1994 was the site of a ghastly massacre by a Jewish terrorist, Baruch Goldstein, who I have to say came from the United States originally. He was a settler, and he barged into the cave with an automatic weapon and murdered about 20 some odd people, and before he was shot dead. That, of course, is not in any way directly alluded to, but as you'll see, the kind of fragile and maybe scary choreography between the two religious groups as they exchange places has something of that dark cloud hanging over it. I'm not here, heaven forbid, to give a lecture on the work of Miriam Ferg. So having just said that as a very brief foretaste, it's my pleasure and privilege to turn the podium to her.
Hi everyone, thank you for coming, and thank you Robert for the amazing opportunity to have you introduce me, which is magic for me. So I want to give a few thanks, of course, to Karen Berkey, who has the Center for Democracy, Tolerance, and Religion, who invited me here and met me in Tel Aviv in a cafe on a rainy day. We had a long discussion, and we realized we are thinking and fetishizing the same subject. So we continue to have a dialogue, and she invited me here, which is amazing. And thanks to the Barclay Center of Study of Religion, of course, and the Israeli Studies Institute, and Jonathan and Brandon, who helped organize all of this, and the wonderful people who actually came to listen. So this is just a start. So I'm actually going to start with, you saved me a lot of explanation on certain things, but just a second, what I wanted to start with is, you don't understand, this is so, so small, okay. I wanted to give a little bit of a personal note on how I started to be interested in these subjects that have started to occupy my work for the last, is it okay if I stand like this? Do you hear me?
Yeah. Just project. Near if you like, there's a hand mic.
I'm just, if I stand, I'm not a good standing person. Oh, yeah, is that okay?
Is this okay?
Okay.
So maybe just to give you a little bit of a personal insight, it's maybe something I never talk about or explain in the exhibitions or in the books or whatever, because it's, I never think it's interesting really, but in this kind of personal situation. So just to, I'm going to show you a really kind of an older piece. This is from 1999. It's a series of Polaroids I took. Why is it not going? Okay, yeah. This is what I wanted to show you. Okay, these are a series of 15 Polaroids I took in 1999 when I was doing my MFA in Bezalel in Jerusalem. So this was after I left Israel at the age of 19. I didn't do the Israeli army. I was a conscious refusal. I said I was a pacifist and I was let go. Today people go to jail for this. Back then it was easier. And I left Tel Aviv and went to New York at the age of 19. And I came back, although it was not the smartest career decision maybe to come back, but I came back because I felt like I belonged somewhere. I wanted to check what is that place I belong to, or I wanted to be near my family, or whatever reason people come back to where they were born. But this a kind of estrangement and a non-automatic, how do you say it? Kind of, I never felt like I truly belonged there. And once you leave and you go to New York and you come back, you don't belong anywhere anymore. So that feeling of not belonging and not belonging to this inheritance, which is Judaism, which is something I was born into, and a very secular family, and I had to understand what it is, and I had to understand what it is to be Israeli, and I had to understand, these things are always questionable for me. I always wanted to ask what they actually are and redefine them for myself. And so I came back, and I went up to Jerusalem, and I always say up because Tel Aviv is low and Jerusalem is high. Jerusalem has this, I love Jerusalem, and for me it's this, you know, Leah Goldberg, the very famous Israeli poet, used to go to Jerusalem once a week from Tel Aviv, and this was in the 60s where it wasn't, there was no train, it wasn't so easy to go, and she used to say she needs to visit them, kind of the next world once a week and come back. So I always feel the same about Jerusalem. I cannot live there, but I have to go at least once a week. So I used to teach there a lot, and now less. But I have to somehow feel, sometimes I go for dinner and come back. Because it's the not belonging there is natural to me. It feels more comfortable in Jerusalem somehow than in other places. And it feels like it's defining me. So a lot of my works have been about that trip and about going to understand what, how space, how a city, how a mythology defines me as an artist, as an individual, how I can use my country as my studio, how I can use the world I live in as something that I want to talk about with other people. And this Polaroid in specific is shot in the entrance to Humble Gates, to Mea Shearim, which is a very religious Orthodox neighborhood, some of you might have heard of it. And the, what you're seeing in the back over there are these trash cans that are these big public trash that they just flipped over and dragged over. And this was in 1999, in order to symbolize the border. This was a way to say, this is our space. And it's Friday, Friday is coming, we have to close the border and signify that the Shabbat is coming. You're not allowed to drive into our neighborhoods. You're not allowed to break the Shabbat, right? You know that there's certain rules to keep the Shabbat according to Judaism. And one of them is not to drive, not to use electricity, not to create anything new. And of course not to disturb their way of living. So it is aggressive. Of course, to the public space, I mean, you have to find ways when you drive around, you have to find ways to go around it. But it's also a form of preservation. And I was interested in that duality. And what Robert was talking before about the kind of, maybe the lack of this ideological statement, is because the more I research and the more I spend time on these liminal spaces, I realize they have two functions. And the one function, which is self-preservation, is something that I can empathize with. The other one, which is in order to preserve myself, I have to push everybody else away, is what's tragic about it. But at the same time, it has, so I think that even if I don't want to be empathic, sometimes I look at the footage when it comes back and I was like, ugh, again, you know, because something of my relation to what I was filming came across as interested and not only critical. And I think it's important for me to say that up front because you will see in the works there's a certain kind of I want to put the situation up front, but I don't want to tell you what you think. I want you to go back and learn maybe about it, and then come back to me, and then go back. So it's not, so the first time you're encountering the work is supposed to mimic the first time that I encounter reality. Because when you encounter reality, you don't encounter the reasons that reality is there. You just see the facades. You just see what's there. So I'm trying to stay like that in order to give you, as a viewer, the space to see things as they are. So this is in 1999. 10 years have passed. I went. I kept on questioning myself where I want to be. Do I want to be in Israel? Do I want to be there? So I went. After my studies, I was invited to France, and there I shot the work of Canicul 3 years later. And I kept on going back and forth to Europe, and I thought my own inspiration would be by looking out and looking into something I don't know anything about. And in 2008, I came back from 2 years in Germany, and I found these Polaroids, which I took 10 years before, and they were like a treasure for me. I met myself again through them, and I started to go back to them and film works that have to do with them. So, and this is because all of what I'm telling you is not a conscious thing, because I'm not an advertising agency. I don't have PDFs with ideas, you know, it just happens. And then I can look back, because I'm very old now, I can look back and I can see what I've done. So everything I tell you is not something that I knew up front. I never know if I'm going to make it, what I'm going to make. It's always very new to me. It's always very surprising to me, even though in a way I keep doing the same things. So I'm going to show you Shabbat 2008, the work Robert was mentioning before, and I'm going to go chronologically and show you three projects, which in a way have to do with religious spaces and the way that you preserve the space, and maybe also the way that objects interact with the space. And when you listen to the sound, you realize that the objects are the thing that is making the sound, not the people. So I want you to pay attention to that when you have a look at that. Maybe we'll put the lights out. So it's 7 minutes. work and move on, or I show you more works and then we talk about all of them. But if somebody has a specific question that they want to ask about this work or something to say, maybe it's also a way to do it. But you decide. Yeah.
I was fascinated that you used the sounds of that setup, and I was just wondering, how did you get all the recordings of the sounds? Is it pretty loud? So how did you do that?
Well, actually, it was pretty loud in the space here, and that's when I do it in an exhibition situation. I will show you that. Actually, I will show you the way that it's being shown when it is shown. So in an exhibition, I make sure that the projection starts from floor level so that you get the space to continue in your own space, at the space that you're standing in. So that's, it's never supposed to be so much elevated from the floor in that sense. So it's not really like film. You're watching it a little bit now in the film situation, but it doesn't hold the same demand for narrative that film does in a way. And the sound is actually, but for the sound, I use a very filmic technique, which is called Foley. And Foley is the way that you recreate sounds in a studio, and then you just paste them on to the image. It's not very simple. You have to be very talented to do it well. And I was working with a very talented guy, and I've been working with him ever since. But it was a conceptual decision to use the sound as something that emphasizes what I was interested in, or the kind of, how do you say it, soen, the kind of uncomfortable sound that is actually, you're forced to listen to in a museum situation, that kind of calls you in when you're walking around the museum and suddenly something calls you in. So that uncomfortableness is something I wanted you to experience, and at the same time experience the muteness that has to do with the lack of communication that was involved in the shooting. I could not ask permission to be of the people that I film, not permission or interview or discuss the phenomena. Understand in the beginning, I want to understand who is closing the gates in what neighborhood, because the work is filmed all over Jerusalem in all the religious neighborhoods. So it's not only in 100 gates; it's in different parts, from Beit Vegan and the 100 gates and Rehavia and different neighborhoods. It's closed all over. So Jerusalem, really, if you look from above, it looks like islands of dark islands and lit islands. And I was really curious about who gets this job to close the gates. Do you inherit it from your parents? Is it just because you live close by? So I had a lot of speculations, but I wasn't really able to talk to the people that I was filming about what I was filming. So the muteness was a decision that came from the lack of communication, and then the edit sound came from a certain kind of plastic experience that I wanted to hyphenate. So these are the two things that have to do with the sound. And it was clear to me that I live in a country that is marked by ideology and these neurotic borders which are not yet defined and hopefully will change. And we're constantly redefining our borders and thinking about this thing out loud, and some of us are trying to think about it, and some of us are trying to keep the borders that are. So it's a big question of how you materialize an ideology. I mean, art is actually a form of materializing a thought or a feeling or a theory, right? So you could say that about politics, you could say that about religion, you could say that about the artifacts that we see around us in this museum, in this exhibition. So I was curious, how does that manifest in real life, not just in a museum situation? How does Judaica occur, and how do religious objects signify religious thought, but how do events signify religious positions? And so the space, looking at spaces as something that needs to be kept in a certain way, allowed me to research on that. I continued to work in Jerusalem. I really literally, okay, just one last thing about Shabbat. When I was doing it, it took about half a year. because I had to drive every Friday to Jerusalem and film these 5 minutes that somebody's closing a gate and come back with this footage and just put it and then wait for next Friday to come, because I didn't have like a crew of 10 photographers that would send all around Jerusalem to film it, and I didn't want to have them. So it was really a collection. As the more film I collected, the more I thought about what am I saying, and I have to be very responsible. This is a very, back then, I think 10 years ago, this was not in the art world also. I think we just started to deal with these subjects in that particular way. So on the way to Jerusalem, there's this huge mountain that's called Mountain of Rest, Har HaMenuchot, and it's not a secular cemetery, but it's a cemetery that was constructed to compensate for the inability to reach the Olive Mount until 67. So it was kind of the parallel cemetery for the citizens of Jerusalem. And I found myself driving and seeing that mountain at the entrance of Jerusalem. And at the end, I stayed and did another work there that's called Kept Alive. And it was dealing again with the kind of territory that defines you and defines your identity as you're approaching death. So I'm not going to actually show you this work because it's kind of a long, it's a longer work, and I don't want to keep you here for a very, very long time. But I have this policy that all my works are on my website full, which is all the other artists always shocked that I do that, but I think it's actually an interesting thing. So I can send you to see Kept Alive and to continue, because it's really literally a continuation of what it actually means to preserve your way of life as we see it in Shabbat 2008. Okay, so now I want to continue to show you two films, but before I show them to you, I want to talk to you a little bit about presentation and how things are actually displayed. So I want to show you Abraham and Sarah, which Robert was talking about before as well. And I'm going to show it soon in an exhibition that Karen is curating in Saloniki in Greece. And this work, as you see here, it has two standing screens. And these screens have 10 meters between them. And each of them has a film, and these films are identical in length, but of course different in content. And when you watch them, you have to be in a position of, it's like a ping pong, you have to choose sides. And that choosing of sides is very important for the understanding of the work. So you can never see them together. So there is never a certain kind of coexistence in a way. And that was very important for me. When I was filming them, sometimes, rarely, I show them one after the other, like you are going to see them now, because we do not have the setup here to have. But you have to imagine that when you're seeing one, you're missing out on something else. And I think that's the installation is a big part of what I want to say. So in a way, half of the work is done in space, and half of the work in the museum situation, in the physical situation. Because I get so much from the physical reality that I want to recreate a certain kind of physical manifestation of it. So here you see in a beautiful space in Paris, in the Jewish Museum actually in Paris, there was an installation that's actually photographed well in order to show this. This is in another space, actually. But just to show the way that they are not, they're separated from each other, they're completely identical. And I wanted to ask that question of what does it mean to show something that's so equal in a very identical way? And how do you actually find the differences when you look at the particularity of each and every? It's really demanding of the viewer, in a sense, to accomplish that kind of perspective. This is in another place, this is in Cyprus, when this work was shown. So it's important for me to have you keep it in mind when you're seeing the works now, one after the other. And you don't understand, my screen is so small. Thank you.
still playing in the background. So we get we get the two of them together. For some reason, it's insisting to be playing.
Okay.
When it happens in an exhibition, it's nice because it creates a reality, but here it's.
Thank you.
side, parallel, there was another screen projecting to the woman soldier opening. And it's always the Israeli soldier which actually manages the occupation and manages the religious sites. So there's a strong union. Whenever you go to a religious site, you do not really get to experience any spiritual experience, if you do think you get them in a religious site, but whatever, if it's not a religious, a spiritual experience, but it is a very bureaucratic experience, it has to do with security. So there's a lot of protocols when you, before you enter any religious space in Israel, you first of all, you face the police, and then you face the army, and then you face the actual people who run the place. Until you get to pray by a grave, you actually have been already serving the army twice just to be able to go there. So it's a very bureaucratic routine. But what led me to Hebron, Hebron is a city that has a double name as well. It's called Hebron by the Jews and it's called Khalil by the Palestinians. It's the biggest city, Palestinian city in the West Bank, and it has one of the most radical settlements of Jews within the Palestinian territories. And of course, you probably know about this, and it's a very popular kind of situation. I mean, popular in terms of it's very much a lot in the news. So I went there, and I realized that inside the cave of the patriarch, or Ibrahim's mosque, as it's called by the Muslims, there's all the occupation that I can see outside, inside one gesture. And when I walked in there for the first time, I noticed that all the chairs were plastic and all the everything was very flimsy and hanging on the walls by this one little thing. I mean, I could only enter the Jewish synagogue. I could not enter the Muslim mosque. And I knew this was a very important place for the Jews, so I asked, why is this so flimsy and why is everything so cheap? And they said that that's because we have to be able to evacuate in 2 hours. And to hear a settler say the word evacuate in Hebron lit up my imagination. And of course I asked to be able to film that kind of evacuation, what they call evacuation. And as opposed to Shabbat 2008, which was done completely without any dialogue with the people I was filming, this has to do with a lot of dialogue with the people I was filming. It was approved by the people who run the place, both of the Muslims, the Waqf, which is the Jordanian jurisdiction over the religious holy sites of the Muslims in Israel and Palestine, and the settlers who are running the place, and the army, of course, who had to approve it. So this was the reverse of a spontaneous kind of trip I took to Jerusalem. It started with a spontaneous trip, but it ended up by a lot of bureaucracy with the army, a lot of time talking to people on both sides, and actually really enjoying the people who work there, which was very surprising to me, because of course the people who work there are just workers, they're not the ones that you can blame for the situation. And they actually are very similar to me, in my perspective, in many ways. So I found a lot of connections that could connect them, but the work is not optimistic, in my opinion, but it was always read in that way, that here we have an arrangement, they will fold their carpets, we will have our things on the wall. Even physically it works, because the Jews don't use the floor, the Muslims use the floor, so we could actually have a joint praying space if we wanted to. But it's not an optimistic situation, because it's not something that was decided by the people who manage the place. This is, of course, a policy by the government, and this is conducted by the Israeli army. So when you see the soldiers passing by, it's of course parallel on both sides, and you see that they're actually checking for, you know, if anybody left anything or vandalized the space, and everybody's locking themselves, and they're locking the Bibles, and they're hiding the books, and they're, you know, putting everything in a pile, and they're protecting their stuff. So you realize there's a lot of fear from each other, that it's not a very joint kind of experience. But because this work was received so well, I became very suspicious of it. And decided to go back to the same place and film another work, which I will show you for a minute how it is presented. Just for a second. Mm-hmm. this is a four-channel work. We are seeing now three channels, and this is the whole space. So you have three channels on one place, and as opposed to it, there's one channel which comes up once in 10 minutes. So I've made this demo for you to see, so you'll be able to see it in this situation. But again, this is space. So the actions are taking space in real world, kind of, in a very sterile environment where you can look at them again in the art world, within a museum context. And suddenly you have this almost performances, because the way people, although this is completely documentary, nobody would listen to my directions. I didn't want to direct anyone. Of course, they were very much aware of the camera. As I said, this was in complete agreement. It had to be in complete agreement. I couldn't be a fly on the wall. This was not a documentary situation. This was actually to set up a situation and film it. So I brought three cameras, and I had one camera in the mosque, one camera in the synagogue, and one camera in the border between them. And you will see the situation that is conducted. I don't want to tell you much about it because I want you to experience this. It's just like you would in an exhibition. So you go into it and you hear, and you see people walk around and you hear them and you see the doors and you don't understand what's what, and then hopefully you ask yourself and then you go to the wall and then you get frustrated and then you go to the wall again. But this time I'll save you all of that. But I just wanted to show you then the role, the physical role, the objects that the images portrayed on are playing in the space. So they're almost like these barriers that you see when you drive around, and there's a cement box that is kind of stopping your way when you try to drive around the West Bank. So they're supposed to kind of resemble these things. And if you know the territory, then you know what it refers to. Okay, so this is the last work I will show you. I think it's 12 minutes. And I will not tell you what you're seeing. It is called Ishmael, which was the son of Abraham and Hagar, his mistress, which Sarah kicked out afterwards. And we have what we have now. I don't know if that's like the correct way of telling the story. It's a very simplified way. But I named the work Ishmael. And it's following, I'll just tell you this one thing. It's following, because some people in America don't really know what it is. It's following someone that is actually calling for prayer. In a mosque, the Muslims are calling for prayer 5 times a day. I don't know if you know, if you heard the sound of it, if anybody traveled to the Middle East, they know it. I don't know if anybody's in Paris, they know it and they hear it. But when I showed this work in New York, a lot of people didn't recognize the sound. They didn't know what it is. So what you're actually seeing is a muazzin. That's the name of the guy who's calling for the, It's the call before the prayer. So everything that we've seen so far, actually, maybe I should mention it in my work, has to do with all the preparation that come before the actual religious event. I never stick around for the religious event. I only care about the bureaucracy that comes before that. So what you're seeing now is a kind of an escort that a religious person, a Muslim person, called the muazzin, is getting by the Israeli army in order to call for prayer 5 times a day.
Thank you. Allah,
So this is a heavier work, in a way, right? And it really came out of, it actually, maybe I'll tell you just a little bit about the architecture of the place. So you were talking about it before. The place is indeed holy for both the Muslims and the Jews. And it's always been divided between the Muslims and the Jews. Actually, the Jews could not enter it until a certain point in 16. Even in 67, I think they only started to be able to pray there. I'm not going to tell all these stories about the steps, it's maybe too much information, but once politically the Jews could enter the place, they had a certain arrangement of hours in between, so the Muslims would pray certain hours and the Jews would pray another hour and so forth. And in 94,
when Baruch Goshen performed the massacre in the cave of the Patriarch, then they closed off the cave for the Jews for about 1 year, and the Muslims would pray in the whole space. And then after 1 year, under the pressure of the government and actually the settlers who lived around there, whatever, everybody was pressuring to reopen it, they opened it and they divided it in a very strict way between the Jews and the Muslims. 80%, the Muslims got the bigger space, 80% of the space was Muslim and 20% was for the Jews. But the space was then divided physically with these doors that you see. And near the doors stood the border patrol. So it was not a transferable border, it was just the border patrol were there to keep it closed. But when they divided it, the place where the muezzin is calling for prayer stayed in the Israeli jurisdiction. It was like a settlement inside a Muslim settlement, which is, doesn't happen, inside the synagogue. And then they had to solve the problem of the Muslims feeling that they could be hurt again by someone like Baruch Goshen. So they arranged this protocol of the guards, of an escort, in which three soldiers and two policemen are coming to the door of the kind of the border, and then the Muslim muezzin is crossing the door and walking in the synagogue protected by these five uniforms. And this situation, I first saw it when I was filming Abraham and Sarah, and I thought, what did he do? Why is he led, you know, he probably did something wrong, because when you have such an escort, you're probably led to prison. But then when I realized he's being protected, I waited a year until they let me film this other event, in order to, for me, it's another answer to Abraham and Sarah being this kind of something that could be a little bit more optimistic than this. And this shows really the absurdity of how you manage an occupation in such a situation. So this escort is happening, it's supposed to happen five times a day according to the Muslim prayers, but under the pressure of the local settlers, they canceled the 7:30 prayer of the Muslim and gave it to the Jews. And that's what you see. You see the mincha. The guy calling mincha, he's actually, Jews do not call for prayer. So this is kind of an Islamization of Jewish, you know, protocols or rituals, which is happening it's copying Muslim rituals in order to show them that they can do it. So it's kind of another audio war that is happening in the space. And so when I show it actually in an exhibition, this other screen is silent most of the time. Nobody understands why it's there. And then once in a while, there is this Jew calling, suddenly disturbing this whole. And I wanted to create this kind of almost tonalic singing between the two of them, which happens very rare. It doesn't happen. And so when I got back home, I got permission from the army to spend 1 day, from 4 o'clock in the morning until 9 in the evening. And that's it. Whether I had focus or not, I brought two other photographers with me. I was standing in the mosque, the two others were standing in the synagogue, and we were filming this, and at 7:30 we came to our usual position, positioning the cameras, and then they said, no, it's canceled. So you gotta go. We went out and got permission from the Chazan, who has an amazing voice, this Jewish guy, who's an interesting guy, actually, to film him doing that, calling for prayer in the Jewish way, you know, calling the mincha. So this was actually kind of a documentary surprise that happened to us, which we couldn't really predict. I was there a lot of times, but nobody told me of this, and I never actually stayed around for the sunset when I visit that place. It's not a very nice place to go visit in the dark. And so that constructed the work, and I allowed myself this play of times that you see. You see the 4 a.m. screen, and the 4:30, and the 12:30. I mean, there's a logic to it. I reconstructed the game to kind of show, maybe, that in that sense, when you're in the space, you have to kind of understand what's the protocol that I'm setting up, the same way that I had to understand what's the protocol that they were setting up. So I want you as a viewer to be confronted with this idea of what does it mean to regiment your view? It's kind of, what does it mean to regiment your existence? You cannot be here, you can't be here, you can't be here at this hour, you can only walk this way in that hour. So in that kind of space controlling, body controlling, which is always in union with the religious events, is what this work was really about. And I continue to work on, there's another work I want to do there, but it's impossible now. Yes, sorry. Yeah.
Sure. Can you use to describe the activities that you're documenting is ritual?
Yes.
And it seems to me that part of what makes this...
It seems to me that part of what makes this work so well is that the mundane ritual, documenting the march down the hallway, putting the carpets down, putting the banners up, dragging the gates, they're all sort of, you know, rituals of that life, but of, you know, not within a, what you think of as religious ritual. Mm-hmm. All, so there's this play between the, you know, sort of mundane
mm-hmm.
ritual. And I guess part of what I'm interested in is if you think of it as ritual, in a way, I think you seem to describe it that way, in,
yeah.
in a routine and the occurrence. And then I had a small question, which when the Jews are yelling Mincha, is I assumed because it was here, it's at the same time as the Muslim call to prayer.
Yes.
It's to block out the Muslim call.
Exactly. It's instead. It's really literally instead. So the Muslims could not call for prayer at that time.
Okay, so what we're hearing is something different than what you hear.
No, you're hearing, you're hearing a juxtaposition of two different times.
Two different times.
Because I wanted to make them come.
Okay, thank you.
Harmonic, but, yeah.
So how much do you feel that ritual of daily life, and do you do works not within this sort of look at religion, that rely on that sense of ritual?
I think what I feel strongly is that I'm being ritualized. So as an artist that's following an event, there are so many rituals that I'm doing in order to follow the event. That ritual comes into play, not just documenting this mundane ritual, which does not call itself a ritual. This is bureaucracy, this is not a ritual in the sense that we know. Well, the word ritual could describe it, but it's not a religious ritual in any way. So I think, yes, that it is a ritual in my opinion, and I want to say that this is the new religion, maybe. Dealing with the space and managing the occupation is the new religion of Israel now. Well, that's a big statement, but it could be interpreted in that way. So yeah. Anybody wants to ask anything?
What?
Yeah.
So when I was talking, particularly in the first one, in Sabbath, but also the next one, you know, just how fragile these things are. So, I mean, those gates aren't going to stop anybody who wanted to get through that gate. And so there's a kind of formalism about the protocols that you're talking about that are, in a way, they would be easy. I mean, not the guys with the guns and the locks and the keys, maybe in the last one, but the other ones require a set of informal participation, but also recognition that somebody's not gonna drive their car right through there, as if it was a kind of totemic power that those guys waved at to stop, and the other guy kind of just drives around them and, you know, gets up on the sidewalk and goes on. I don't know what you make of that. I don't know if that's something that's interesting to you to think about these kind of tenuous ways in which these things are preserved.
Of course. I mean, that was fascinating to me. And I even drove a lot of times I came Saturday morning to see if they were moved. Not even an inch, they were not touched. So they have this presence. Once they are, I filmed, of course, all the taking apart because it's Saturday evening, they're putting them back in place. But I found that much less interesting than putting them in place because
The moment of putting them in place, what I discovered, is a moment of demonstration. It's a moment of meeting the secular people. That's what it is, because you go to the edge of yourself, you go to the edge of your community, and you go and you meet these cars, these big machines, which are, you know, nothing like you, and they have these lights, and they drive, and they shouldn't be driving, and there are all these people that are doing their mundane stuff, and they're not at all caring about the Shabbat, which is coming. So it's really a moment of asserting your own position. And you're using it, I thought of calling it a dance with objects, you know, because that's what it becomes. And I think in Abraham, Abraham and Sarah, Sarah also the objects are very present, and what kind of object masquerades a space to be one way or another, and how easily it is to take them apart, and how easy it is to hide the origin of the place, as we see later in Sarah, Sarah, and the Abraham. So yeah, the idea that these objects hold so much, they receive so much respect, and people actually kind of, people listen to them, obey them, in a way. And they're just police objects, you know, they're nothing nice. But the fact that they're police is not an innocent thing at all. This actually means that this is a cooperation with the police and the religious elements, and even the radical religious elements like the Satmas from Neh Shearim, they are also cooperating in some way by touching these police barriers and not hiding their origin. So it's a big, I showed it to in that community, and they were a little bit upset that it was a police borders, and that they actually cooperated with the Israelis in that sense. It was funny to see that this, even this, so everything has a symbolic meaning. Nothing is nothing. I mean, nothing doesn't, you know, everything has a meaning.
But in many ways it looks very dangerous, but that police sign and the fact that it comes out of multiple negotiated positions between the state and the religious people makes it much more robust, in fact, than the tenuousness of the object. The object is tenuous. The intent is incredibly robust.
Of course.
You know.
Yeah, of course, and it has a strong meaning. I mean, there were riots every once in a while. There was a period of strong riots of, not anymore, of secular Jews that are objecting these barriers in Jerusalem. We don't have many left in Jerusalem now, secular Jews who will go and riot. There are some of them who do not want these barriers to be placed in public space and change the public access to every place in Jerusalem. So there are, they're very, very important. But what I enjoyed is to see the kind of difference between who's actually doing that. You know, these kids, that for them it's a game, for them it's like a moment of performance, and they have, it's like a stage for them. It's a moment where they actually show what they think, and they get their body, you know, they're the chief, and they're like the chief of the neighborhood, you know, they get to close the gate. So that, and the difference between that and a certain kind of, you know, a bigger decision to allow this by the police is really, it's what happens when it's down to earth, what happens when it actually has, someone has to do it, and when somebody decides to do it. But this whole status quo about how to keep the religious nature of Israel, which was defined by Ben Gurion already in 48, you know, how to keep the Shabbat, not to keep the marriage, not to keep the divorce, not to keep the religious life of Israel, the status quo after 67 about how to deal with the religious sites, that's a government policy, that's not a religious decision. And it's a political decision. And the core of it is the union between, is the, what I think is a tragic union in between religion and state in Israel.
Obviously, men as well. The anomaly of one Jewish female soldier is an anomaly. And so the view of this type of religions that we saw is perhaps we should do something about the men. Maybe things will change.
Tell me about it. I was the only woman in all these situations. trying to direct it, you know, saying, trying to understand what's going on. But it was very, and then actually I did another work that's called The Right to Clean in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, where I filmed a woman, because the church is full of women asking for things. You cannot avoid them. It's not the men who run the place. I mean, they do run the place, but the one who take care of the place are women. And that changed my whole work, just to be able to look at a woman doing, because for years, everything I did, everywhere I go, it was only men. In the cemetery as well, in Ramon Fort, it's only men. And the Palestinians who are building the graves, were digging the graves for the Jews, which is another work that I've done after Shabbat. So it's you're very right. It's a very radical thing. Yeah. I guess if women were there, it would have been different, huh?
And speaking of like preservation, burying and everything, it made me think of, I don't know if you know this from living in New York, but there's these areas in Brooklyn where Hasidic Orthodox Jews live, and they have, there's public buses, but only Jews will be like kind of allowed on these buses and will take these buses. And there, it's just kind of known, just like a valley, just kind of known that only Jews will be going on these buses, however they're public. So it's just like this interesting dynamic and kind of barriers of this one community versus kind of all of New York City, where, you know, people come from all over the world. So it made me think of that.
So you can't go on this bus. If you go and pay a ticket, they don't let
the. I mean, you can, but it's just known that you don't.
Did you try?
No.
Try. You'll change history. But it is a community that wants to keep itself separate. It's not imposed on it. It's actually probably under a lot of negotiations and demands to keep these buses only separate. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, separateness makes the space havdalah, right? This thing that makes the space different than anything else is what also keeps it isolated.
Idea of border that you're working on, and it seems to me what makes it actually like enforceable or kind of, you know, this robust perhaps is actually that they are so mobile. Mm-hmm. They are not like the permanent, that the fact that they are mobile makes them actually much, you know, like a tool for power or, you know, all these, you know, the security or whatever. I just want to, like, you know,
yeah, you're right. It's even stronger, I guess, when people obey something that's so flimsy and they let it stay in that way. It makes the statement even stronger, the agreement of the situation even stronger.
I have some questions about the piece, about your decisions about where it begins and where it ends. Because the beginning is with the settlers, the Jewish settlers, taking off the Judaica, I think.
No, that's Abraham.
Talking about Abraham.
Yeah. And the piece ends with the settlers coming back in and putting the stuff on, right? Am I mixing two different pieces, or?
Yeah, you're mixing the two different pieces.
Okay.
That's what's supposed to happen in the space, and that's confusing. It's confusing in the space as well, but it's even more confusing here. So in Abraham, what you're actually seeing is what the army calls Kharig Muslimi, which is an abnormality. They call it the Muslim abnormality, which happens 10 times a year. It's part of the arrangement in the cave. So the Jews take away all their stuff, or they hide it, they protect it, whatever, from within the synagogue, and then they leave the synagogue. This was not filmed. But then the army opens the gates and lets the Muslim in, and they bring the carpets, and they turn what was until then a synagogue into a mosque for 24 hours only. And that's Abraham. And then 4 months later, I filmed a Jewish abnormality, a Charik Yehudi, which was filmed on Parashat Chayei Sarah, which is actually an interesting event in the cave, because it's an event where the cave celebrates itself, because this cave was supposedly bought by Abraham to bury Sarah. So
So it's not a religious holiday in all of Israel, but it's a special event where the cave celebrates itself, and so the Jews ask to have the whole cave. And in that case, what you're seeing are the Muslims taking away everything, putting it aside, and then the doors open and the Jews enter. So it's two separate events.
So it's hard to tell beginning and end, and then solution.
Yes, it's very hard.
So that leads me to there is a certain beginning and an end with the material, with the objects themselves, because the walls are cut out of stone, and you see that there's a clear permanence to one set of objects, and clear impermanence and temporal dimension to the stuff put on the wall.
Yes.
You know, a curtain does not have the same standing as a wall and as marble. And to me, that sort of complicates the actions. It gestures towards something that's, you know, there is a spatial beginning, maybe there is a temporal beginning as well. And, you know, this is, this arrangement that you described is the result of the massacre. And this is something that perhaps is not clear. The fact that settlers have access with regular basis, with the protection of the Israeli army and the border police, is the result of an arrangement after the massacre occurred. So in a way, to a certain extent, if this is a site of a massacre, and these protocols that are the result of a clear power dynamic, then to what extent we can also push into that direction? Are we watching this protocol as an extension of a massacre occurring? It's very bizarre. It shouldn't be normalized that we have people with guns in a place of worship. This doesn't occur in any normal basis. In most places of worship around the world. So,
so far I agree with you. Yeah.
Yeah, but to me, I've been to the mosque and I've been to the Jewish side, and I could only enter after I was, you know, camouflaged with a group of Europeans entering the Jewish side, and after I was asked for my religion. And only after I said I'm an atheist was I allowed to the Jewish site. So I'm aware of all these protocols and the tensions that they can create. But
maybe you should let Nira Perry answer, because it's getting very late. Okay.
No.
It's getting very late for what? Sorry.
No, I just wanted him to finish his point.
Yeah, my point is, if temporally the beginning and end are confused, in your work, do you try to suggest a beginning and an end to the events unfolding through the objects portrayed? That's one. And another question I have is, as a secular person, regardless of your religious upbringing, to what extent, or how can you sort of negotiate your secular biases when doing such work? Because I noticed even for the and Sarah probably, when the settlers re-enter, they're taking pictures, and one of the pictures was highlighted with the audio. So there is a certain fetish even when you're a religious person. So how do you guard against these, or maybe indulge in these fetishes when you work with religious topics and religious communities as a secular person?
First of all, I enjoy your observant look, because you really notice all the details that I kind of, it was important for me to put them in, to give exactly this, I mean, there, I filmed the whole event, and of course this is a 4-minute film of each event, so the shots were very carefully selected and became a ritual by themselves, and how they follow one another. So of course all these hints are there when you see that it's a Herod and Herodianian, how do you say that in English? Herodianian building originally, and it was a mosque for most of it. And of course it was never a synagogue as far as I know, so this is of course, as you said, this is a result of the power regime in the West Bank in the way that the Jews want to be there. This, of course, and yes, I am secular, so I observe things. I think that's what gives me a different perspective on the events, because I don't observe them with a certain kind of attachment to the space itself and to the rituals that I'm supposed to perform, that I'm supposed to perform there as a Jew, and to whoever is buried there, if there is anybody buried there. That's also very mythological. Nobody really knows what is actually there. So I'm hoping to show the absurdity of how you maintain such an absurd situation. And it's maybe the never-ending story that I'm portraying, this loop, right? There's no beginning, there's no end. Nobody, you don't know much about the space from my film. You have to go learn. I just want to show you this one event that can make you go to study about this place. Because otherwise I will do a whole documentary and I will bore myself anyway, because I studied it in this. It's information. And I'm not a documentary, so I'm not obliged to give you that. I'm not, in that sense, I said to myself, I'm free from educating. But also I only want to kind of highlight something and make you interested in it. So, but I think that the feeling of that is embedded in my medium, because my medium is a filmic medium, but it does not have the same kind of narrative regulation. You don't get the lights, you know, then you get up of your chair and you go away. It doesn't, it's just a loop, and it has to maintain itself by being constantly projected. And that mediumatic quality is embedded in the content of the work. So in a way, this kind of never-ending loop is a statement. And that's maybe kind of, you know, it's, I don't know, it's like within the work for me. It's the sadness of the situation, and it's that you don't care anymore who's there, who's what. It's just like, it's ridiculous that this is happening. This should stop and normalize itself in another way. And the Jews should pull out of the West Bank, and whatever the political aspect of it is. But I think it calls. And like Robert was saying, I don't want to say these things up front, because then it's propaganda, and then it's not, it doesn't interest me simply to say it. I'm there to investigate and find an event, a moment, a happening that in where the space displays itself. And this whole arrangement happened because of the space. So architecture was actually, you know, the massacre and architecture together created this weird arrangement. But I'm faced with what is formally there. And then you have to go research a little bit. But if you get the sense of the absurdity, and you get the sense of the tragicness, and you get the sense of that it's not going to end, which is what I feel, then that's good for me. Because I work for that feeling. And then you get to have more information if you go and do your research and you learn about it. But this one event for me was enough to highlight this kind of protocol of how it's actually being kept.
I think we should give Mira a rest now, and then an opportunity to have a rest.
Thank you.
Thank you.